Hier Jörn Alige.
Yes. Welcome, welcome everyone. And as Maurice said, it's actually a good thing that we are not so many people, so we can have more hands-on and more discussion in the end. Because we want to also, it's not about only what's new in Wallet. I also want to show you this thing. I have a hands-on here, basically. So we use Wallet Connect to open a box, and then you can get drink vouchers. And as you are so few people, the chances are higher. And we also like have Status IM hardware wallets in there. So basically, after you open the box with Wallet Connect, it looks like that. There are your vouchers, some stickers, and on the left, the hardware wallets. It would be super awesome if the hardware wallets only get taken by people that actually have an Android phone with NFC support, that it can really be used. Because currently, they are quite expensive, but they get cheap. So it doesn't really make sense to just collect them and they get dust. Please really test with that. So you can take one if you open it, but really then also test around with that. So now a little bit, what's new in Wallet? One thing that really, really changed is the account management. Before, I thought it's a really good idea to just create an account in the beginning that you can just get started. So, you know, you start the app, you have an account ready, and you can do things. Actually, that was not the best idea, because it depends on the use case, how you want to use your wallet. Not all want to use it with a burner wallet. Some want to use it with different accounts, for example, with a Trezor. So now, when you start the app, basically, you select your use case, concentrated on what kind of account you want to start. Like the first is the burner. Basically, I took this name from Austin Griffith. That's just Austin Griffith coined this wonderful term of a burner wallet, so everyone knows what's going on there. That was actually how it worked in Wallet before. Like, I didn't have a password because I think that's easily to get started is the thing. So it was a burner wallet, but I was never calling it that. But the name is really good and now also like distributed in the whole ecosystem. So that's now called that. The second thing, and I think you basically should go usually from a burner to a Trezor. So there is, I think, nothing much in between. We have more stuff in between, but I think that's the way to go, because if you then really have an account that is worth something you want to protect, you should protect it with a hardware wallet. And that's connected via USB OTG. Now with the Model T, with USB-C, it got really easy. Because before it was a bit fiddly, you had to have this OTG adapter and put it in the right direction. But now with USB-C connected to the phone, that's really easy. And it's now also updated to the recent Trezor. That's also a little bit of a drawback. I couldn't get backward compatibility without a lot of overhead. So I'm just now, like, well, it's just compatible with the latest version, so you really have to update. But that's also how Satoshi Labs does it internally. They really want you to update and then force you basically to do that. I was looking into backward compatibility, but the problem is, like, it's protobuf and it would increase the app size a lot, and I'm really caring about the app size, so I didn't really want to do that. The next thing is, for example, if you switch your phone, it's import key. So you export it on the old device, you import it in a new one, you also don't want to create a new account, you just, you know, you start the app, you import it. The next thing, if you don't even want to have keys on there, is watch only, so you just specify an address or scan it. And then you can just watch it. So some people just don't trust their phone. But if you just want to watch, if you get something incoming, you can only use that for that. The next thing is NFC. And that's also very, very new. That's basically about these key cards, which are also like in the box. They are really new. And Wallet is the first wallet that supports the key card now. It doesn't yet support all features. Currently, you can make transactions and set up the wallet, make transactions, and that's basically first of all it. But it's a good thing to start. There are way more features that this keycard can, like what's really interesting is the pinless derivation paths, basically, so you can pay at POS systems. And imagine it, like the mixer recently also came up, so you imagine like a mixer that always fills up like your latest pinless derivation path, and you just pay with it in a private manner. That opens a lot of possibility. And also, like in the mobile case, a good use case is copying of these cards, because that's really the problem. You want to copy these cards without exposing the key to the device that's copying it. You want to do a direct copy. Unfortunately, you can't direct copy the cards, but the keycard team basically invented a a system with multiple wallets. You have basically witnesses in between that nobody sees the whole key, but you can still transfer the key from one card to the other. That's very important for backups. I think that opens up a lot of possibilities, but it's quite new, and I want people to actually try that out. The advantages to a real hardware wallet is like you don't have to plug it in. It's NFC basically, you just tap. So you tap on your phone, and then basically your transaction is done, or got signed, and then it's done when it's sent somewhere. So you don't have to plug in some USB. It's a bit more convenient that way, and it's also way cheaper. But what you see, like the big disadvantage, of course, of that is that you don't yet have displays on that. So it's a bit less secure, but you have these trade-offs, but it's a good trade-off for a lot of use cases. That's how it looks, basically, then. You either have to select you want to do a new card, or you have an already initialized card. Unfortunately, currently, you need to, like, basically, when you have a new card, remember three things. It's like a PIN, 6 digits, a PUC, 12 digits, and a pairing password. For the daily usage, you just need the PIN. You need the PUC if you forget your PIN, and the pairing password, you need that if you want to pair with a different device, basically. So in day-to-day usage, you just really care for the PIN. And then basically, after you press that, it tells you like to bring the NFC tag close to your phone, sign the transaction, and then it's basically the same as always. That's the other thing, like people ask just for PIN protection. I think really you should go from a burner to a hardware wallet, but some people asked for that. I don't really know why, because I think then the protection of your PIN or the protection from your phone is basically, you should only use that when you like do 20 euros, like pay for drinks or something like that. It shouldn't be a high value, and then the obstacle of having to remember a PIN is higher, and the security gain is not that much in the end. But people asked for it very loudly, so I added it, and you can now protect it basically. And also you see that's an internal keypad, because also people asked for passwords. That's even more rudimentary, because I also think, because here, for example, you share the keyboard, basically. These keyboards are external services. You share your password with Google, and that's a problem. So rather, I think, use PIN, but some people ask also for password. You can now also do password protected accounts. What also what a lot of people don't find is basically the shortcuts, because what you really often want to do is just scan something. And with Android, you have these wonderful shortcuts. So you basically just long press on the wallet icon, and then you have scan and transact. If you need other shortcuts, let me know. But these are the use cases I know, especially scan. For example, if you want to use it with the box, just get the scan. You don't have to go into the app and then select scan, bam, 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 deep in there. You just shortcut scan the QR code, and you have your use case ready in the end. This is the new account listing, basically. That also has a little bit changed, especially when you want to manage a lot of accounts in the end. Then you want to basically star some accounts that you really use often. You want to just select the ones with a key, or just basic filtering. And you also like the indicators here on the top right. You see basically, you see my cursor here? Yeah. Basically, these are watch-only accounts. This is a burner account, PIN, PUC, so the images are used always that you recognize from creation to do that there. And if you're everything that is basically this greenish color, you can press, for example, like on the burner, then you export your key. So that's your key export then. These are the networks. There's also like a lot of more new networks now supported, basically everything that's in Ethereum list chains. You see these different symbols here. Gurli, for example, has this lightning, and that means you have really, really fast access to a faucet. Just one click, and you basically auto your address, that your current address is auto-filled, and it's just basically one click to fill your account. Some like Rinkeby, where it's just like this present thing, it's a bit more complicated, because you have to do this tweet thing, and that's a bit more cumbersome to, I can't just invoke that from the app that easily. So basically, you can still go to the faucet, but it's a bit more manual process. It's not really that fast. That's why I also start with Gurli, because it's basically just, you open, create a burner, forced to give me money, and then you have your money and you can spend it and try things out in the end. And also now with the girly pusher, you also automatically get pushed a token, so you can transact token, transact ether, and can try the different stuff with that. Yeah, these are basically all the networks then supported in the end. It's all a chain ID network, and if you want to add some networks, I love small networks, just add them with a pull request to Ethereum-less chains, and then basically you can press the sync button on the top right, sync it, and then the new chain is also added. Yeah, that's it. That's the new tokens. Tokens basically the same, like Girly, the root token then also has this faucet link. Yeah, and we have standard tokens, and I think now over 1,000 of them. Yeah, and those are collected in Ethereum-less tokens, so if you want to submit your own, you can submit them there. That sounds a bit stupid, like just a changing toolbar, but it's also like a security implication, because when you make the wallet your own, you basically recognize clones or recognize fakes that just pop up, but they might not know the color of your wallet, so you're especially warned before. And I want to do that a little bit more, so you can now change text and background, so you have some... just otherwise, it's like quite easy to make a fake app that just pops up and you put your credentials in there, or makes something malicious. You have also this security information now. It basically gives you your latest patch day. But it's only important if you really hold a key on the phone. So if you use it with a Trezor, it's not that much important. But if you store your keys there, you should really see that your latest patch of your system, not of the app, but your latest system patch not so long ago. You have to see routing, because routing would break the app isolation. Also warns if the phone is rooted, that would also not be good. Checks for lock screen and different other stuff. Yeah, now I want to talk a little bit. What had talked about what was added, and now I want to talk also like this is a thing. Perhaps people have read the blog post recently of the Ethereum Foundation, like subtraction is a thing. And subtraction is a really beautiful concept, and I also removed stuff from wallet. Not only screens, like before, I was also removing screens that just deduplicated. One thing is a bad thing. I moved away from the light clients because they just provided so bad user experience. Like the default, there is still a flavor for light clients, but the default is now not anymore. It's now RPC. I want to move to Enqubed. It should come in Q2. Like I got the deadline Q2, and then basically that the minimal verification. I think it's a much better. User experience in the end, and you still don't have the centralization problem. Yeah, let's see when that comes out. I will directly add it, and it might be quite easy because then it is also RPC based. And I also like removed the Firebase flavor. I had it in before because also Wallet Connect in the beginning had Firebase, so I had it added. And I had it as a flavor because I needed to put it out anyway for Fdroid, so it was not working on Fdroid. So I had two flavors, like one with Firebase for Fdroid, and one with Firebase for Google Play. But I now completely removed it because it's not used for Wallet Connect anymore. And it also like really helped. I got a bit in the direction of like making the app build reproducible, and Firebase was a problem there, alongside a lot of other things. So I now just did the step to remove it, and also like helps new developers because Firebase you also have the secrets, and then I had to have a Git crypt in there and hide these secrets. So now there's no more secret, and there was a problem before for people that just try to build the app, clone it, try to build it, but then you rely on the secrets to work. That was a bit a bad thing, so it's now completely removed. Subtraction for the win. Yeah, a bit in the reproducibility. I had it already recently, building reproducible. Unfortunately, now there's a new bug where just one bit is different. But we'll figure that out. So that's on the forefront. There is a new field, but I think that can really help in the future, because there's also a problem. How do you like you know this app is open source, but how do you know that the binary you get belongs to the source you've seen? And that can really help, so we can really then spread out, different people build the app and agree on the hash for the release hash for the commit hash, and then you can really trust this app way more. And there were also like some organizational changes. Everything was grown in the beginning in the Wallis organization. But there was this library, Ethereum, that was growing in Wallis, but now matured into a new organization called Computing, because there's also people that the advantage of having everything there in Kotlin is you can not only compile it to Java and use it for Android, for example, but you can also use it to compile it to JavaScript and have like basically static typing with JavaScript. But I didn't want to have that in that because it was then exploding, also like in Ethereum split in different modules to have it easier. And it was just growing in the, so it's better to split the organization there and have a bit of separation of concerns. Yeah, now a little bit Bullet Connect also updates like to the new standard. You can also like try that out. Here we have some things to try it out later on. Also, Pedro will talk a bit deeper for sure about Wallet Connect about that afterwards. But these basically changes like the new standard also make it visually a little more pleasing. Please try it out. And now we also see that the adoption gets by higher. Like now MetaMask is on the train, so. We get traction and we need more dApps now to try it out. Like this is also one dApp and Pedro shows a dApp. Let's do more dApps and really try that out because I think that's a beautiful concept basically to separate wallets from the dApps. Yeah, that's it from me basically. If there are any questions, otherwise Pedro will go directly with Wallet Connect. Yeah, thank you. Oh, questions, yeah. It's minimal verification clients, basically. So it's a smart contract where you can register as a provider of data, and then you have a stake there, and then you basically sign all the block hashes you like on request, and you can lose your stake if you sign the wrong block hashes. Or like saying, so I can trust the data regarding to the stake. Basically, also depends. Like sometimes, like if I pay my coffee. I don't need the millions of stake because it's just about the coffee. So then it's also like, can somebody with small equipment basically do it? Yeah, but just it's a project from Slockit basically, and they did talks also about that. Unfortunately, it's not like the server is yet released, so you can do the server part already. But the client part I need, especially the C++ one, is not yet done. But they said like Q2, and Q2 is basically a month or something like that, so it should be in there. But I think it's a nice solution because the thing is with light clients, it sounds light, but it's still heavy. You know, you still have to have this peer-to-peer chatter. You still have to download a lot of data. It's less than a full node, but it's still a lot of data in the end. And then if you see, you don't only have one chain, you have basically multiple chains. You do that for everyone. And let's say like main chain was now 50 megabytes. But then you have different chains and always have this also this waiting of until it's synced, and that's for the users really bad. Like you say, have to wait until it's synced, your phone gets fucking hot, your battery is empty, users are just angry, and it doesn't have anyone. It's the right thing to do, usually. That's also like when, yeah, and I was really struggling to remove it. Basically, it's not removed, it's just basically not the main thing. It's still a flavor, you can build it and use it. But the main thing is now, and it also much smaller, like the APK size got much smaller, and I want to target like emerging markets, and they don't have the newest phones or like data lines. It's really important that the app size is also small. Like has so much advantages, and basically also that it's like the traffic is way less traffic also. Like we have like allowances of gigabytes, like some people don't, you know, it's like every megabyte counts. And a light client is really like it's sucking data. So and in Woodhide, just it's like basically you just do RP in the end, simplified. You just do RPC requests and you get the proofs with that. So and then yeah.
So just a follow up. What do you have a proof of? Is basically the latest head of the blockchain, right?
The block hash, yeah. You have a signed block hash basically, and from that you can go back and prove your. But it's basically, I'm an application developer. So watch the talks from Slockit about that. And yeah, I don't want to go too deep into that because I, as an app, basically just leverage that. and that sounds like the good solution, but scrutinize it. If you're really into that, really scrutinize before I put it in. They put out, it's a white paper out, read the white paper, yeah, and then, yeah. Other questions? Yeah.
You mentioned that you're not using the Light client anymore, but also not the Incube stuff yet, so what do you use in between?
Now RPC, like basically everyone is doing. Okay. It's just now basically you use RPC, and it's not good, but basically everyone is currently doing it. Like, and it sounds bad, like everyone jumps out of the window and you jump afterwards, and I really struggle to do that. But the thing is also, like, for a lot of users, strangely, it doesn't really matter. You know, they just use it, and then they compare the user experience. And then they see your wallet and getting your phone hot, consuming all your data, and, you know, and still doesn't work sometimes, because Light clients also sometimes it just fails for some, like, yeah, and just a horrible user experience, and people just say, yeah, your app is bad. Okay, and the thing is also, like, with these systems, you can also make it more gradual. You can also, like, basically have a trust slider in the end. You know, you might be okay with starting, like, with minimal trust, you know, just trying things out. And then things get more serious, and then you increase the trust slider. And that will also, in the end, cost you money. And there's also no thing, also with Light clients, it will cost money in the end. It's just not sustainable, you know. Currently, there are some, like, but you also see when there's a spike, then the Light client servers are also, you know, that doesn't scale. And there's now, like, there's this project VipNode, where you basically rent Light client servers. But you also have to see with different nodes, it's really good what they are doing. But there's still the problem. Like, phone still gets hot, but at least you get a Light client slot. But imagine you don't get any slot. So, yeah, it's a big mess. But does that answer your question? Or, yeah.
Cool.
Other questions? No, that's not the case.
No more questions? Okay. Thank you so much for all this great news and information, Ligi.
You're welcome.